Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to Awake to Oneness Radio. I am Caroline Chang, your host. The mission of Awake to Oneness Radio is to inspire the world to awaken to the universal truth of oneness. Science and spirituality are both telling us that we are literally all connected. We are literally all one. So what you do to another person, you literally are actually doing to another aspect of yourself. And when the world awakens to this universal truth of oneness, there will be peace on earth. Today's show topic is Entangled Minds with Dean Radin. Dean is the chief scientist at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, and he's the author of The Conscious Universe, Entangled Minds, and Supernormal. I first learned of Dean's work while watching the film What the Bleep in 2007. What the Bleep was really the film that kind of woke me up. First of all, it was the first time I ever really heard anything about quantum physics. And to find out that quantum physics was actually telling us the exact same thing that spiritual teachings were telling us, that just blew my mind. And actually, it was the quantum physics, understanding quantum physics, that made spirituality understandable to me. So I really am so thankful that Dean is with us tonight, or this evening. Welcome, Dean, to Awake to Oneness Radio.
Hi, Dean. Thank you very much. There? I'm happy to be here. Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, thank you. I wasn't sure. I didn't hear you for a second. Thank you. I'm so honored to have you because, like I said, it was What the Bleep that woke me up, and I had no idea what quantum physics was, proving. And it's not new science, actually. It's been around for a long time. But you are the scientist. So can you please share with our audience some of your background and your work?
Well, I have a pretty conventional educational background. I have a undergraduate degree in electrical engineering and a master's degree also in electrical engineering. And I went on to get my doctorate in psychology from the University of Illinois in Champaign-Urbana. And then I worked, my real first job after getting my doctorate was with Bell Laboratories. Most of that was involved with advanced telecommunications research and development. But I was always interested in consciousness and the extended capacities of consciousness, including things like psychic phenomena, but mm-hmm. from a scientific perspective. So over the years, I've done a number of experiments, and for the past 20 or 25 years now, I've been able to spend full time doing research in psychic and mystical experience.
How did you get started in that research?
Well, fortunately, by taking a pretty conventional educational track within electrical engineering, you learn a lot about computers and methods of making measurement systems of various kinds. And then within a psychology curriculum, you learn a lot about research methods. So those same techniques that are used within engineering and in psychology are applied and have been applied for over a century now to study all kinds of interesting things. And the same methods can also be applied to study psychic phenomena. Because fortunately, most experiences that people talk about as being psychic are really psychological phenomena. They're things like perception and experiences that people have. And what we do then in the laboratory is listen to a story that somebody tells about their experience and figure out a way of testing it in a rigorous condition, but in the laboratory. So that means taking an experience, a spontaneous experience typically in the world, and artificially constraining it in a way so that we know the difference between a coincidental response and we're able to measure exactly whether the effect is due to chance or not. And the control is important because then we know that the person is not getting an inadvertent clue about what's happening and they're not cheating, and we can measure the results and repeat them and so on. So we're using the basic tools of science to study what might be thought of as unusual mental phenomena. So that's what we do.
Okay. Now, explain, because one of the terminologies that I learned from the film, what the bleep was, entanglement, quantum entanglement. And I know your book is in, one of your book is entitled Entangled Minds. Are they related, the idea of quantum entanglement and entangled minds?
Well, yeah, I use the word entangled in that case for two reasons. One was actually three. One meaning of entanglement in this case was that people report experiences where they seem to share some of their mental activity or sometimes their emotional activity. So telepathy is a kind of entanglement in a metaphorical sense. A second sense is that quantum entanglement is talking about some strange form of connection that transcends space-time between what looks like isolated particles. And it could be photons or electrons or virtually any kind of particle, energetic or material, that they are still connected even though they look like they're not connected. And importantly, connected through space-time. Not in a classical sense, but in this strange non-local quantum sense. And the third meaning is that entanglement suggests something like a ball of yarn that's tangled. And that implies, or the connotation there is that this is a very complicated relationship. When you look at a ball of yarn, try to figure out how is this thing stuck together. Of course, it looks like a gigantic mishmash, like a knot. And that is the case for these kinds of phenomena that we're looking at. They're very complicated in terms of understanding it, in terms of how they work, and in terms of the challenge that science faces in trying to understand these things. That makes it both frustrating at times to study these phenomena, but it's also very challenging. And I enjoy the challenge, which is why I've stuck with it for many years now.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the experiments that Einstein did back in when he was around he called it spooky action at a distance. That I just wonder if you can explain that experience, because that to me is where I see the quantum entanglement, where when he did that experiment.
Yeah, Einstein was a theorist, not an experimentalist. So
okay.
He would do what he would call Gedanken experiments, which means a thought experiment. That's what theorists like to do.
Mm-hmm.
There's a big difference then between doing an experiment in your mind and doing one actually in the laboratory. So what Einstein was referring to is the notion of non-locality, that spooky action at a distance means that somehow something happening over here is affecting something at a far distance, and in a technical sense, beyond the light cone. What that means is that if, and from a classical physics perspective, if I I want to influence something that's at a distance, I can do that. I can throw a rock and cause it to hit something at a distance. But the speed with which I can do that is limited to light speed. And that was, of course, from Einstein's famous theory of relativity. He proposed that light could only travel at a certain speed, and that was a limiting factor. And his theory of relativity has been tested, and it looks like he was correct, that there's a limit to light speed. Well, that limit means that it should not be possible for something at one point to influence something at another point if it's far, too far away, and it takes light longer to get there, then the interaction appears to happen. And so the term non-local, which is an important portion of quantum theory, is saying that there do seem to be connections between things that is not limited to light speed. In fact, it's not only that it's faster than light connections, but there doesn't seem to be any time passage at all. So when I use the term that an effect transcends space-time, it's in this sense of being non-local, that things are connected through space and time. And when people talk about the illusion of separateness, what that's referring to is non-local connections that transcend space and time. And so that is a major break in physics that quantum theory has shown us as compared to classical physics. Because in classical physics, you could not affect something at a distance beyond the speed of light. So that was one of the primary changes in terms of our understanding of the physical world.
Okay. Can you explain that a little bit, I guess a little bit more in layman's terms, the non-locality that you're speaking of, and how that really changed how quantum physicists, anyway, looked at, I guess, reality, in a sense. Like you said, there's a difference between the classical physics and the quantum physics.
It really is a change in our understanding of reality. Quantum physics has two elements to it which are different than the classical world. So by classical physics, I mean what Newton worked on and many, many other physicists for hundreds of years. And we can now look at what they have done as a kind of a formalization of common sense. Like if you throw a rock, the rock will have will trace a parabola through the air and it'll fall, and you'll be able to predict with very high precision based on classical physics where the rock is going to end up. The vast majority of daily life and of the making of machines and the making of almost everything relies on classical physics. So these are the physics of the everyday world. Quantum physics started because in trying to use those methods and those ideas to understand the nature of light, that it didn't work anymore. Now, this is before Einstein came along with his theory of relativity. But even before that, there were already aspects of understanding the nature of light where classical physics simply didn't work anymore. So quantum theory was developed as a way of trying to account for certain anomalies. One was called the ultraviolet catastrophe. The other one was called the luminous ether. These are just names given to phenomena that classical physics were not explaining very well. And the upshot of quantum mechanics, initially starting as a mathematical trick, essentially, it's basically there are a number of different ways of getting to the same theory, originally called matrix mechanics, which is a very complicated mathematical approach, and then Schrodinger's wave equation, which Schrodinger was able to develop and show that his wave metaphor, or the equations of waves, were able to account for the same phenomena that Heisenberg had created when he used matrix mechanics, this complicated mathematical idea. Regardless of the specific method that was developed, and these are all just equations after all, When people started looking at the implications of the equations, one of the first to do that was Einstein and his colleagues, who said, well, these equations couldn't possibly be correct because they imply that if you take a photon and you cause it to split into two, and you have the two photons going on their merry way at opposite ends of the universe, and you measure one and you get a certain result, then that will change the result that you get on the other particle. In other words, there's some kind of spooky action at a distance going on between what looks like two different particles. And so for many years, for decades afterwards, people thought, well, maybe Einstein is right, that the spooky action at a distance does not exist in classical physics, and maybe it's a mistake in quantum theory. So in the mid-1960s, the physicist John Bell came along, who came up with an idea of how to test whether spooky action at a distance is in fact correct. And tests have been done starting in 1972, and since then, in greater and greater refinement, it was shown that this spooky action at a distance in fact does exist. And it changes our concept of what the physical world actually consists of. And we're talking here about what amounts to the fabric of reality, very deep level of physics, and what causes things to hang together. It is not what Newton and many physicists thought up until about the beginning of quantum theory, so for hundreds of years. It is something quite different. But when the new theory comes along, it has to be compatible with what was seen before, because we have a lot of evidence and Newton's theories were correct. So it has to be compatible with what was known before, and it has to show that it's able to account for other phenomena which are not accounted for by by classical theory. So that's what quantum theory does. It shows that all of classical mechanics was basically a special case of a more comprehensive theory. And someday we will find that quantum mechanics, as we currently understand it, is also a special case of an yet even more comprehensive theory. So we're in the midst now of maybe 80 to 90 years of having quantum mechanics as a better physical theory. But a lot of physicists now at the leading edge are working on the next, sometimes called super quantum theory, or sometimes called sub-quantum theory. Depends on their choice of words. But they're all looking for ways of expanding what we currently understand as the physical world. And eventually we'll get beyond quantum theory into something new.
So would it be true to say that the quantum theory, the quantum entanglement, is basically saying that we are literally all connected? I'll just try to put things in very layman, simple terms, but that's how I understand it. But I'd like to hear you, as I'm not the scientist, so I like just for you to maybe, because I say that to my audience all the time. They hear me say it, but I'm not a scientist. So is that, in fact, what quantum theory is saying, that we are literally all connected?
One of the problems in trying to take quantum theory and interpret it in a popular way is that in the process of doing that, it becomes so simplified that it's actually not really correct anymore. So it's like taking a beautiful natural scene and creating a cartoon out of it. The cartoon will have some resemblance for the actual scene, but it's been simplified. And the urge is to simplify it down to a point where everybody can understand all of it. And the fact is that today we still don't, even professionals, don't understand what quantum theory is trying to tell us about the world. And the way that we can show that is if you look for interpretations of the ontological status of quantum theory, meaning what does it actually mean? There's something like somewhere between 12 and 20 interpretations that have been proposed. And when you go to conferences where you have physicists and philosophers who specialize in trying to understand what quantum theory means, there is no agreement. There is no one agreement as to what this theory is trying to tell us. And that's actually a clue to how important it is, because it's extremely precise in terms of designing electronics and designing things at the nanoscale. You have to rely on quantum theory because it's a much better theory than classical theory. But when it comes to figuring out, well, what does this tell us about the world, nobody knows. So one interpretation is that because of non-locality, that at least at a very deep physical level, what appears to be separated particles, in fact, are not actually separated. So again, remember, this is an interpretation, one of many. So that interpretation says that maybe what quantum theory is showing us is that at deep physical levels, there is the illusion of separation, but there is no separation. So that is correct, but it is one of many current interpretations of what is actually going on. And it is, in fact, this interpretation, this illusion of separation, which it does resonate with ideas in mysticism, because within mysticism, that is one of the overriding notions, that we are one, and the mind is one, and there's one consciousness. And that then is the where this the idea came from, that quantum mechanics and spirituality are not exactly, they're certainly not proving each other because they come from different domains, but they show that there may be a relationship between what we think of as the physical world according to our best physical model and the physical world as described to us by the great sages throughout history. That's where that is pointing.
Okay. Well, okay. I hear and understand and agree with everything you're saying. For me personally, I like to simplify things so I could just kind of get a better understanding of it. One of the things I heard about, like, a rock. If we take a rock and we look at it underneath a really super, super, super powerful microscope, you're going to see molecules, you're going to see atoms, you're going to see all these moving particles within that rock. I don't know how many millions or billions. But so say if we're just looking at that molecule, you know, you wouldn't see, if you're zooming in on one little molecule, you can't see that it's a part of this, you know, rock. So do we call it a rock or do we call it a bunch of molecules? Do you follow me?
Sure. Yeah, and that of course is true for any substance, including the human body. Human body has trillions of cells. If you were to look at any one cell, you wouldn't know whether it's one person or another person. But that's a little bit different than the notion of non-locality. In fact, that's very different. Because, well, it's true that if you look at a given cell, you can't tell where it comes from. If you look further down, even much lower than the level of molecule, into the subatomic realm, it's not only that you can't tell where the electron or where the quark comes from, but from a quantum perspective, when you're not looking at it, and this is another major change from classical to quantum physics, when you're not looking at the particle, it is everywhere. It's only when you look at it that it actually localizes. And
right.
So this observer effect in quantum mechanics is also a major puzzle. No one understands the quantum observer effect. That's where the notion that consciousness may have an important element in the physical world, that's where that idea comes from, that observation changes how quantum quantum behavior.
The location. It's kind of like the double split experiment. Yeah, the double slit. I said it wrong. The double slit experiment, which where photons are a wave until you look at it, till you add a conscious observer, and then it it's no longer awake. So, and that kind of touches upon the multiverse theory and all possibilities. But all of this, like I said, for me, it was the understanding quantum physics on a simple level, not the math and all that, and not, you know, but understanding quantum physics from what I understand of quantum physics, it helped me to understand what I was learning on the spiritual side. And they did seem to be saying the same thing for me.
Right. And it does for many people.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
So if you talk to some physicists, they get quite upset that there's this notion that physics is somehow supporting or proving spirituality, because they don't agree with that at all. And this is partially because from a strict perspective, a formal perspective, quantum mechanics is a mathematical theory. It's extremely precise, and it doesn't obviously show that consciousness is related to it at all. There are many physicists who do actually think it has nothing to do with consciousness. There is another group of physicists, and this is simply echoing what I said before, that there's a lot of different interpretations of what's going on here. There is definitely a minority of physicists who say, well, there is an observer effect. There is some strange effect having to do with the observer. It's not, by the way, it's not conscious observation. It's any form of observation.
Right.
It changes the behavior, and this, you refer to the double slit experiment, which is correct. It's one of the ways of showing that quanta, the individual quantum particles, quanta exist in at least two forms. It exists in a wave-like fashion or a particle-like fashion, and when it behaves one way or the other, is dependent in some way on how it is measured or how it is observed. So we've been doing experiments for 7 or 8 years now where we have an actual double-slit optical system. We seal it in a housing so that you can't see what's going on inside. But we ask people to, with their mind's eye, to look at the double-slit and to imagine that they could see the photons. And so what we're doing is we're using consciousness, their awareness, to see something, but not with their physical eyes, with their mental eye, like their mind's eye. And we're testing then, does the photons going through the double slit, do they tend to collapse into a particle as a result of mental observation? And what we have found now in 16 or 17 experiments is that overall the evidence is quite clear that the wave-like behavior of a photon actually does become more like a particle. It doesn't collapse completely into a particle, but in that direction, and statistically speaking, very strong evidence. So what this says is that the meaning of observing a quantum system does have something to do with mental activity. And this will actually be very compatible with the notion that was presented in the movie What the Bleep. It is definitely a controversial topic within mainstream physics, but we now have actual evidence, experimental evidence, that the cartoon that was presented in What the Bleep, remember the cartoon with Dr. Quantum?
Yeah.
Showing the double slit experiment? Okay.
Oh, I was thinking of the Flatland. Okay, go ahead.
No, not Flatland. No, there's another cartoon in one of the What the Bleep versions where Dr. Quantum demonstrates the double slit experiment and shows what happens when you observe it. So we've done an experiment now where the observer is humans and doing the experiment very much of the way that the cartoon tried to illustrate. And we have found that it does matter how people use their attention and in changing the behavior of the quantum world. And that's now a second way of suggesting that one of the notions and this, by the way, is not so much about spirituality, but more about psychic phenomena, that it supports the notion that what you think about the world, the way that you direct your attention, it manipulates the world. It is not to a huge extent, but to an extent that could be measured in the laboratory.
Wow.
So
that's
there's
awesome.
another indication that some of the ideas in the movie What the Bleep have empirical support and
mm-hmm.
repeatable empirical support. But again, I would caution listeners to not run away with that idea too far, because we still know very little about what is actually going on there. And it's difficult to simplify it to the point where we suddenly think that we actually understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Leading edge science, which this is,
mm-hmm.
we have many more questions than we have answers at this point. So I would take this lightly as a suggestion about what's going on, but certainly at this point not any form of proof.
Okay. Well, that brings me to the thought about humans, human capability, what they can physically hear, what they can physically see. So as a scientist, you use instruments. So the human is measuring from his own instrument. You know, so we couldn't see, like, galaxies or stars or planets without these powerful telescopes. We couldn't see the atoms and the tiniest particles without powerful microscopes. We can't see those things with our naked eye. And I just know that the human can see is very limited to what is really out there. Are you following me? So the experiment is the human. I mean, when I say the experiment, the tool is the human. He's going by what he can see, what he can hear, and what his senses can sense. But it's very limited.
That is correct.
Okay.
And so we develop instruments to extend our ordinary capacities.
Yes. But I kind of throw that out there just to say that I know, because ancient spirituality has been around much, much longer than quantum physics. But it just seems like quantum physics is just kind of catching up to what ancient spirituality has been teaching for many eons. So I understand what you're saying when you're saying that the theories are not, nothing is definite, nothing is proving really anything, but also we have to factor in the fact that humans are very limited at this
mm-hmm.
point.
Well, one of the reasons why it's not a good idea to hitch your wagon to quantum mechanics yet is because, and this is a big difference between spirituality and religion, or spirituality and science, I meant. The difference is that if you look at what mystics have said throughout history, and even contemporary mystics, they all basically say pretty much the same thing. There's the perennial philosophy, so-called, where there's certain truths that sages have experienced and talked about for a long time. But quantum mm-hmm. mechanics is in an evolutionary path. It comes out of classical physics. It is part of this struggle from a scientific perspective to understand the nature of physical reality. And so quantum mechanics is not the end of the story. It's a story that is still in the process of changing. So you don't want to link these ancient perennial philosophies to something which is changing, because that would force the perennial philosophy to change too. And so far, after thousands of years, the perennial philosophy is called perennial because it's not changing. So I think you're absolutely right that what the shift from classical to quantum physics, if we think of that as a direction, like an arrow pointing from classical to quantum mechanics. That arrow is pointing in the direction that the ancient sages were talking about. And okay. Eventually, we're likely to get where the arrow is pointing, but we're still on the very beginning of this path. If humanity manages to live for another 10,000 years, we'll be much further along in terms of our physical theories, and I suspect that you're right, that it will start to converge more and more with what we currently think of as spirituality. But by that time, we will have scientific or mathematical expressions and models which would be, from today's perspective, would be indistinguishable from what people have talked about in terms of spiritual concepts. But we're still far away from that, but I think that is the direction that we're going.
I agree. One of the things I say all the time, for me, I liken the whole concept of oneness and non-duality. I know that scientists like to use that word, non-duality. For me, oneness and non-duality are mean the same thing, that we are all one. And my belief is, I don't know if it will happen in my lifetime or when it will happen, but I believe that mankind is going to evolve to know, just like when hundreds of years ago when mankind thought the world was flat and mm-hmm. was afraid he was going to fall off the edge of the earth if he went too far. And if someone back in those days said, "Nah, I think the world is round. You're not going to fall off the edge," they would have hung him, probably. They would have thought he was crazy. Now we know, we've been out in space and we've seen the world. We know it's round. I believe at one time, in some point in mankind's evolution, he will come to know that we are all one, that we are literally all connected. And so, and when that day happens, I don't know. And I believe what you're saying, that science will at that time have, undeniable proof of our oneness. So I feel like I'm just a little ahead of the curve, maybe, but not. I know I'm not mm-hmm. alone. I'm not alone in belief. So I believe that's the direction that we are heading.
Well, even in science, science has been very good at cutting the universe apart. And that's mm-hmm. where we have many different disciplines, and people spend their entire lives studying one tiny little piece of the universe. But it's called mm-hmm. the universe for a good reason. It's one thing, universe.
Yeah.
Because our mental capacities are still pretty limited, we can't know everything. So we have to carve it up into little pieces where we can know something in depth. Maybe one of the evolutionary tracks that we're on is computers will become smart enough to be able to pull together knowledge from many different fields and begin to actually grasp the oneness of the universe. Like knowing, if you knew everything at the level of very high expertise in every scientific discipline, it's almost hard to imagine how you could do that. You can't study long enough to be able to do that, and you can't cram it all into your head at the same time, but a computer can do that, in which mm-hmm. case, at that stage where you begin to unify the various disciplines that science has been so good at carving out, I think that your sense of science and spirituality beginning to converge, I think that is correct. And I have a very limited, I'm having to rely on my imagination here, but I know a little bit about a lot of different disciplines and a lot about just a couple of disciplines. But because if you read a lot of different disciplines, you'll understand some of it in more detail than others, but you do get a sense of a rich form of interconnection that actually spans every discipline that there is. So if you can imagine a computer, maybe the human mind can do this, but it's not going to be Homo sapiens as we currently are. It's going to be some other species like Homo superior or something of that sort in some future evolutionary sense.
Mm-hmm.
We might have the capacity to actually see the big picture. And the big picture, I think, is going to start looking more and more like what the mystics talk about, except we'll have better language for it. I mean, one of the reasons that there's so much discussion and misunderstandings and minor understandings of spirituality and its relationship to science is that we don't yet have language to talk about it properly. So that will change too.
Yes, very true. Very true. I do believe we are, as a species, heading in the right direction. I think it's important that those of us who are on that path of moving in that direction help to maybe share that information with others. That's why I use the word awaken to oneness, because I really believe, then this is from the spiritual end, that this is something we do already know, that we have forgotten, that ancient civilizations knew these things, like how did the pyramids get built? You know, ancient civilizations kind of had a little more going on than we do, I believe. This is my belief. And so I believe at one time mankind was more aware of these things that we are now just starting to relearn, remember,
mm-hmm.
wake up and remember. That's why I did title this show Awake to Oneness, because I believe it's mm-hmm. something that once we awake, because it's like when, like I said, for me, I shared this with you earlier, and I have shared this on the show before about the one sentence in What the Bleep that truly woke me up to the idea and the concept of oneness was when Lynn McTaggart said, "The biggest problem in the world today is the illusion of separateness." And when she said that, it just, everything I was struggling with spirituality made sense to me. So it was mm-hmm. quantum physics that made me understand spirituality, but it's just like I'm like wow, you know, I was just amazed how far man has already come with quantum physics, and I know mm-hmm. that man is going to go much farther, you know, in days to come. Now, I believe, are you actually Awake to Oneness Radio is going to be hosting their first event on Global Oneness Day, which is Saturday, October 24th. We are going to be mm-hmm. hosting a celebration here in the Poconos, where I live, Northeast PA. A lot of people don't even know where the Poconos are. People will tell me, where are the Poconos? Northeast Pennsylvania. So we will be hosting a Global Oneness Day celebration at the Pocono Mountain Library that day. But I believe that's going to be a 13-hour free 13-hour tele-summit that is hosted by Humanities Team. I believe you are going to be one of the speakers that day. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes,
I just wasn't. Yes. So we are going to be gathering for about 4 hours. So we're going to mm-hmm. be gathering at the, well, because we're East Coast, and it's going to start 8 o'clock West Coast, and so that's 11 o'clock our time. So we'll be able to come together and listen to the first few hours of the telesummit live, which is great. I don't mm-hmm. know which hour you'll be speaking, but it is the 6th annual Global Oneness Day, and I know that Humanities Team is collecting signatures and bringing it to the UN, so Global Oneness Day will be sanctioned as a global holiday when they collect 100,000 signatures, and they're well on their way in collecting those signatures. So I have been celebrating Global Oneness Day since the first, which was October 2010, mm-hmm. because I had my awakening to oneness in, I believe it was the month of October in 2007. So I'm just happy to be able to to share, to be able to celebrate with people in my area on that day, and really looking forward to all of the different scientists and spiritual people and people from all walks of life. I kind of, I've been, the last few days, I've been kind of having to explain and to people what oneness is about. People want to put us in a box, you know, and classify us as spiritual or a cult or a religion. And I keep, it's just no. We're not in a cult. We're not in a religion. There are people from all religions, from all walks of life. There are atheists, there are agnostics, you name it, every major religion in the world and minor religion. There are people from all walks of life involved in the oneness movement, which is basically the mission of the oneness movement is for peace on earth. When you know, when you think about it, if everybody woke up tomorrow and knew in their heart they were connected to everybody on the planet, and that if what they did to another person, they are literally doing it to themselves, there would be peace overnight. I mean, if everybody really woke up to that universal truth, and I believe it's a universal truth, and I believe one day mankind will know it as a universal truth from scientific evidence as well as from ancient spiritual wisdom, and it would be peace on earth overnight. So we're taking baby steps in that direction, which is awesome. And I'm just happy to be able to use this platform like internet radio. It wasn't around how many years ago. I mean, for me, I can do a talk show with some of the top scientists like yourself in the world, some of the top spiritual leaders in the world. I can do a show from my home office, which is amazing. So technology, and like you said, all of the new technology is coming from the advancements in quantum physics. All of that we're moving leaps and bounds in the direction of where the world, we already have, the internet is our nervous system. You know, we're already connected. You know, I get emails from people in Africa, Malaysia, all over the world saying, you know, I got my show, they listened to my show, and it inspired them. And that just, if I get one email a week, that I'm happy. You know, that makes me continue in this mission of just sharing the message of oneness, that we are all one, and it's all really about love. Just love your neighbor. You know, whatever, doesn't matter. It's not about a religion. You know, you practice the religion that you believe in, but just love your neighbor. That's all it's about. And I think sharing that message can never go wrong. You know, you can't lose with sharing a message. And that, for me, that's why I kind of like to simplify it. I know what you're saying. You're a scientist. and you feel like, I understand what you were saying about when you take a quantum theory or a quantum experiment and simplify it. But a lot of times, if you don't, for some people, they just, you know, they're like, okay, what are you talking about? And for me, just understanding oneness simplified everything for me. I keep thinking I want to write a book of spirituality for dummies, just because now, to me, it's simple. It's simple. Mm-hmm. We're all connected. We're all one. And it just made life very easy for me. Simplified my life. So I wanted to be able to share that. But I truly, truly appreciate you taking your time and coming on the show. I know you're going to be speaking on Global Oneness Day, which is October 24th. Do you have any other speaking engagements coming up that you would like to share?
There is both Quantum University has a series of free lectures happening in a day or two, beginning of October, with some of the same people who will be involved in the Global Oneness Day. And
what
also
was the name of that again?
Quantum University.
Quantum University, okay. Is there a website people can go to?
Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm sure if you just look up Quantum University Integrative Medicine Summit, you will see it. Or if you go to my Facebook page, you'll also see a list of that.
Okay. Can you share your URL, your Facebook page? URL is that
Dean Radin? Yeah, just go to Facebook and look up my name. And by the way, it's pronounced Radin, not Radin.
I'm sorry. Radin. Okay. All right. And so that's coming up in a few days, you said. Awesome.
Yeah.
I know go ahead. Sorry.
It's similar to the Global Oneness Day in that there's a series of free lectures. I think these are longer. There's more like a webinar, whereas the Global Oneness Day, I believe, is radio and internet radio, but not webinar.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's coming
up. Awesome. Thank you for sharing that with us because I was not familiar with that. I know also this weekend is the Mind, Body, and Soul Expo in Philadelphia where Michael Bernard Beckwith will be speaking. Hopefully I get the chance to see him on Sunday. So there's a lot going on in this area where... it's definitely spreading and growing. And I heard someone recently say that it's time to come out of the closet, you know, because I think a lot of people may even feel this way, but afraid to share their thoughts with others just because they feel that it's taboo. Like, I think I've heard you speak of that with scientists. Especially scientists. And well, next week my guest is going to be Dr. Larry Dorsey. I'm not sure if you're familiar with him. He wrote the book One Mind.
His name is pronounced Dorsey.
Dorsey.
And yes, I know Larry very well.
Thank you. I am so sorry I am pronouncing everybody's name incorrectly, but thank you. Yes, he will be my guest next Friday. And he wrote the book One Mind. I know he wrote several books, but the book that we will be focusing on in our discussion will be his book One Mind, which is amazing. I discovered him on YouTube. I discover all you guys on YouTube, and when I discovered him, I was just very, very blown away. And he's a medical doctor, so that I've had Dr. Bruce Lipton on the show, and heart math, and it's just amazing, and I'm so grateful and so thankful for all of you experts that have been studying and working in this field for many, many years and coming on and sharing your knowledge with us. Thank you so much, and sorry, I mispronounced your name, so it is Radin, not Radin.
Okay.
Thank you so much. I do appreciate you coming and sharing an hour with us. And time always flies by so quickly. Before we go, I did want to ask you, could you share with us what does the Institute of Noetic Sciences, what is that all about, the Institute of Noetic Sciences?
Our institute was started by the Apollo 14 astronaut named Edgar Mitchell, who was the sixth man to walk on the moon. And the idea of this institute began with him when he was on the way back to the Earth and for a moment didn't have anything to do, which is unusual for an astronaut. And he looked out of the space capsule at the Earth from a few hundred thousand miles away. And at that distance, you see it as a ball hanging in space. So you have the blackness of space and this bright blue ball with from space, a very, very thin atmosphere. And it looks very fragile from Earth. And the thing that struck him initially was that everything we know about everyone you've ever met, anyone you've ever heard from, everyone in our history, all came out from that blue ball. Everything. So that struck him to such an extent that he began to feel a connection with all of humanity, all throughout time, because after all, he's a part of that little blue ball. And as far as we can tell so far, we suspect that there are other planets out there with people on them, but we haven't found them yet. So that experience pretty rapidly evolved into a full-blown mystical experience where he felt connected not only to life on Earth, but to life throughout the universe, and describes it in very much the same way that mystics have described throughout history. So when he came back to Earth, he was so stunned with this mystical experience that he had in space that he was determined to use the tools of science to try to understand better what is that mystical experience trying to tell us about the nature of ourselves and about reality. And so he, coming out of an engineering and the Navy and the NASA, was interested in whether science could actually gain the competence to be able to understand these kinds of strange inner experiences. So the word noetic is a word that is translated from the Greek and is the same root word as the word Gnosticism. It has to do with ways of knowing, and not just rational ways, which is what science uses, but intuitive ways, psychic ways, mystical ways, and so on. So we study all different ways of knowing about ourselves and about reality.
Wow, amazing. That is amazing. So, yeah, I hear a lot of people who have done deep meditation, and some even, it doesn't matter how long they've been meditating, but there's been many people that have had that experience of feeling one with everything, mm-hmm. the universe and everybody, mm-hmm. Through a meditative state, a mystic state like that. And so that is amazing. So, and reports of those experiences also are kind of, what kind of is, you know, what makes me feel on a heartfelt level. You know, heart math talks about that heart intelligence a lot. From my heart level, I really feel that the oneness is what's real, because it just feels that way to me from a heartfelt level. And so I'm going more with my heart than my head when I speak of oneness. But that's amazing. Right. Well, thank you so much. I truly, truly appreciate you sharing all of your knowledge, and especially that story of the astronaut. That was amazing. Thank you so much. So I don't want to hold you up any longer. The hour flew by. And I truly appreciate, and I will be listening to you on the 24th. And also, will you be also speaking at the Quantum University webinar coming up in a few days?
Yes, I'll be doing one of the webinars.
Okay, great. So I will be sure to be tuning into that as well. Okay,
great.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dean.
You're welcome.
Please have a wonderful weekend, and God bless. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.